Hello boys and girls, this video is going to be a little bit dense. We're going to talk about general quaternion algebras over some general field, and in particular we're going to talk about them in terms of representations of 2x2 matrices. So I will say a lot about the general abstract case, but the equations that I'm going to go through are going to be in terms of their most important representations, 2x2 matrices. And it's also not the case that this video is just about the quaternions. It's not about the, not only about the Hamiltonian quaternions with their relation to the, for example, 3x3 rotations or special unitary groups. We're going to cover these things, but this the video is actually a little bit more general. It talks about quaternion algebras, which is a broader class of algebraic structures that all have a kind of theory that looks like the quaternion algebra, the quaternion algebra, and a lot of the formulas look extremely similar. It has a strong tie to theory of involutions. This is an algebra, it's a vector space with an involution, and so also reduces to the complex numbers, two-dimensional. We're going to discuss why and how that happens and in which cases. It relates to quadratic forms. I will in this video view them just like the norm of the algebra and how it plays a role, and then the whole spiel about how it relates to group theory. We are also not going to just discuss one representation. We are going to look at all these algebras and various representations, although the parametrization of the representation is going to be similar, since we are just dealing with these 2x2 matrices, with the caveat that we also have a general field. Although in the most cases I will point out to what the, how to think about it. The simplest case is over, you know, over the reals and how they behave like the normal quaternions. Okay, so before we get into it though, subscribe to the channel. I don't say that often enough, sadly. I have a plan for the next months. This video, like a lot of things come together here. It goes a lot in the direction of the Lie algebras. The quaternions will give us like a super important example of an algebra where you can look at the Lie bracket as well. Then you have, you know, Pauli matrices. It also relates then naturally to quantum mechanics, and so but you don't even have to go there. It's like the group theory is right around the corner. I talk about a bunch of representations also that we can start talking about the object as they lie around in the category, and we can look at the morphisms and so on. This is all like a lot of things come together here, and at the same time it's just also from a practical perspective very important. I use them literally every day at work, the standard quaternions anyway. Okay, so subscribe to the channel now. I also have, like, I made a drawing for this video. This is the just the complex plane, and I will refer back to that when appropriate, especially when talking about the standard quaternions, and see how the ways in which the complex numbers are embedded into this particular quaternion algebra and representations, and then I will take the objects from this image about the complex numbers and tell you in which way to generalize it in, so that you have a conceptual understanding of certain quaternion algebras as well. Okay, finally I also want to point out that I mostly follow a bunch of theorems from the starting chapter of this book. So this is a guy who has you know, in the last few years written a book on quaternion algebras. You know, that we are going to be interested in going in the Lie direction, But the quaternion algebras, as they connect to quadratic forms and so on, you know, they generalize complex numbers, and you have an analytic theory of quaternion algebras. You can talk about zeta functions all day long. There's really a lot to say, and this book is already like 700-800 pages long, and he covers a lot of ground. He has he starts out abstractly, but also gives all this talk about representation naturally. We are going to talk in terms of the representation. He don't necessarily is doing that. So this is one reference if you are interested in the more mathy theory kind of things. He also refers to another tomb by some guys who at the end of the 90s wrote about involutions. So this is a book, like an algebra book about involutions. The Quaternion have one, and they developed quadratic form theory that intermingles with the theory of quaternion algebras. I'm not going to talk about like uniqueness results and so on and so forth, right? I really want to get at the practical things that I need for other videos, and the algebra, Lie algebra notions, and give you an image that you have in mind to understand these kind of things. Okay, I think I can close this. So let's get into it, right? I'm going to go through these pages. It's just 4 or 5 pages. I've written down this text, and I will maybe jump back and forth between this and the image. And as you expect, I will need an hour, and I hope I'm not too hasty, because it will really help if you like think along, and you can also stop and draw images or whatnot. Okay, so as I said, we're going to look at an F algebra. This is going to be an algebra spanned by the generators. You can think of them as spaces of vector spaces. And this algebra is designed in a way so that it is non-commutative. It's not trivial from a algebra perspective. It's not like a field. It's not like the real or complex numbers or something smaller. But nevertheless, it's also designed in a way that it breaks down quickly. So the algebra relations, the squares of some objects can always be expressed in terms of smaller things. And so you end up with an algebra that is always exactly 4-dimensional. And this is like a level where you have non-trivial effects, and nonetheless, it's not too complicated. We're going to talk about the 2x2 representation. This is not super limiting, because this is already the important one. And the jump from the smaller representations to bigger matrices or general other representations is not too far. Of course, there's always this big jump between finite representation theory and infinite representation theory, but yeah, so be it. Okay, we have these ABC, these are non-zero parameters, okay, from F. And these are, for a given representations, these are fixed, right? So if you fix A, B, and C, then you fix the defining generators, the defining matrices in our case, that then make for the algebra. The parameter C is not really important in the sense that this just moves between representations of a given algebra, and you think of them as one of two values. This will almost not appear in the whole paper, the whole text. This is basically just to say we're dealing with several representations at the same time. On the other hand, this A and B, they will define different quaternion algebras. So depending on what you choose for A and B, you might deal with a structure which is a quaternion algebra, but which has fundamentally like peculiar properties. And I say it right away, the cases that where it collapses to the normal like Hamiltonian quaternion algebra, the ones that you think about if you hear the quaternions, are going to be the ones where a and b is minus one. This is a special case, as we will see. You will automatically see that a few things happen if these two are negative at the same time that make for special situations. So I spoiled you already. The algebra is always going to be four-dimensional. If you approach the topic abstractly, as is done, for example, in the book, then you just start with these two generators and you impose basically three equations on them. And then you can talk about the representations. In this video, I make it a little bit more simple for us. I start already with a representation, but it will be sort of obvious how this can be also worked with if viewed in abstract sense where we don't have a representation for I and J. This is because these laws make the algebra collapse to a certain extent pretty quickly. So we have these two matrices, okay? For the most part, I keep A, B, and C open, but as I said before, you think of them as some three fixed numbers, and then you look at the I and J, right? So you might think of A and B being minus one and C being one, or you might think of, you know, A and B being two and C being the square root of two. So for C, you really just think of them as either C being one or the square root of B. B over the square root of B is just the square root of B, right? Like, no, the square root of 5 divided by the square root of 5 is just the square root of 5. And so if you take C to be the square root of B, then the J matrix is symmetric. This is the one nice thing, and you can pull out the square root of B basically. While if you choose C equals to 1, then the nice thing is that here in the left corner, there's a 1. It's also easy to work with doing matrix multiplication and so on, right? As you have observed already, you have here a square root in there, right? So the number that is going to be there might be in a field extension. So as I said, if this is minus one and you consider, for example, all numbers like as a vector space, this matrix is as a part of vector space over the reals, then the square root of one is the complex unit. It's not in the reals, and so this breaks out of the field. But then you work with it like this small field extension, where if you take the square of the square root of one, then you get one, and you can still calculate with that. So these are the two. These are two fixed matrices. You know, you choose your A, B, and you have some fixed matrices. I will again state the theorems in terms of the abstract cases, and I will tell you when I choose a case. Since we are going to have an algebra that is a vector space, you can, this is a basis, you can work with the vector space also by rescaling the basis, right? If you have a basis of a vector space and then you multiply the base, then you have just a different base, but nothing crucial happened. This is the reason that you, like the important cases to consider really are the cases where A and B are from the set that has one and minus one. These are field elements. And as I said, minus one is one, the major important case, and the case 1, 1 is also looked at often. Okay, so far so good. I introduce right from the start two extra definitions. We have the unit matrix, I call it E in this case. It fits together with the small letters IJ and so on. Could also call it anything else. And right away I introduce this letter K, which is defined as the multiplication of I and J. So in our algebra, the multiplication is going to be just a matrix multiplication. So I times J is in the algebra, and I'm going to call that K. You can, you know, do the matrix multiplication of this. It's just normal matrix multiplication. You end up with this matrix. This has all the letters in it. And now, you know, you start with, think of the field that you have and the 2x2 matrices, right? We have really just picked up a priori, like a subset of the 2x2 matrices. And what we see now is that these matrices, these particular matrices, you know, this diagonal which is traceless, and then this J, which is also traceless, and the resulting multiplication of them, this is also traceless, and the unit matrix is not traceless. These happen to have particular properties, which are the defining properties of the quaternion algebra, which are as follows, right? So if you multiply I with itself, you know, this is really simple. You have just the first component is going to be square root of A times the square root of A. This is just A. And similarly, minus square root of A times minus the square root of A is just also the square root of A. So we find that I squared is just A times this other matrix, this unit matrix. And similarly, you can do the matrix multiplication here. If you multiply that, then you will find out where do we have this here? The C actually cancels out, and the J fulfills a similar relation. J times J is just B times the unit matrix. So we see this A and B characterize what the square of I and J is, right? Okay. And in this case, this is why we have this notation here. This is why we have AB here. This defines how the building blocks behave. And these matrices are also chosen in a way that they are anti-symmetric. So J times I equals minus times I times J. And these are the defining properties. Basically, what the book does is it starts with these properties and then shows all these particular matrices, like these families of matrices, are a representation of that. These are the objects that we are going to deal with in this video. You have already seen how this C like doesn't even appear anymore if you multiply J with J. So this is like not going to be important. Also, what's going to be important in this video is the determinant of the matrices in the algebra. And since if you build the determinant of this matrix, and determinant is basically this times this minus this times this, then a C also cancels out. That's why C is not so important. It's just choosing a different representation, right? If you choose a different C, then you choose a different J or K also. Okay. And so we have seen that I and J are anti-symmetric, and the squares of these I and J is also very simple. And it turns out that the rest of the multiplication is also for these particular two matrices, and everything that they generate by multiplication is super simple. So you can take a look, you know, if you take, for example, I times K, like we have already defined K in terms of I and J, and the matrix multiplication is associative, so this becomes just A times the unit matrix, and so this is just A times J, right? Also I times K also happens to be, if you follow along with this, you know, if you switch around this with the third law, then you find this is also anti-symmetric. So it turns out all the matrices with letters I, J, and K, they are anti-symmetric. And finally, K is also of order 2, basically. So the square of K is also, just like I and K itself, if you square it with itself, like if you multiply k with itself, then you also get something proportional to the unit matrix. And you can see what happens here, right? K is defined as I times j. You flip around, in this case, I flip these, you get a minus sign, you get two j's. Two j's give you b, and the unit matrix, you're left with minus b times I times I. So this is this, right? And c doesn't pop even up here. And now, since no new matrix was generated by multiplication, and since I, j, and k are three non-commuting but different matrices, you see that the space you spent is four-dimensional. So whatever A, B, and C is, we're dealing with this four-dimensional vector space. You can think of them like in terms of like a basis for where you take four components and multiply four components with each of these matrices, add them together, then you get a vector. The vector is four-dimensional, but the whole thing is, of course, just a 2x2 matrix. Yeah, okay, I already said these things. Also, yeah, so, you know, the I times I is basically A. You know, if I don't want to say times unit matrix, then just say A, because anything times the unit matrix, this is basically the axis in this space, which is the same as F, right? It's the same as the underlying field, just times some one-dimensional basis vector, which is the unit matrix. So this is really just F. I mean, along any axis, you can multiply with any F, but this is the unit matrix commutes with all everything else. So everything, everywhere the unit matrix is multiplied with some other element of this algebra, you have the trivial multiplication relation where you can flip around the two sides. You say the unit matrix lies in the center. The center is the set of elements of this vector space which commutes with everything, and in fact everything along the axis of the unit matrix is literally already the center. There's nothing else which commutes with everything, and so we have seen that I times I is A, j times j is B, and k times k is minus ab, right? And so here we now see the first time why a equals b equals minus 1. If you set everything to minus 1, it's special. Namely, because if you have a times b and a and b is minus 1, then this is also minus 1. And then suddenly any element times itself is minus 1, right? Then any element behaves like a complex unit, so to speak. Right, and this is going to be a theme that basically, in the case of the quaternion algebras where a and b are both minus one, then all these basis vectors that don't commute, I, j, and k, they behave all like the imaginary unit, and together they form so to speak the imaginary space, and the real space is along the unit matrix, along the center. Okay, so at this point, I will refer to a little bit complex analysis. So I will now discuss this image. Okay, so what we see here is just an image of the complex plane, right? I've drawn this image. This is what we see as just a complex plane, and I already choose a notation which will generalize to the particular the normal quaternion, the Hamiltonian algebra, and I, you know, recall how the complex numbers together with the exponentiation and so on and so on work, and how to visualize the imaginary unit. Because this will directly translate then to the quaternion case. So we have the complex plane. This is why I write the C here, right? I have two axes, the imaginary axis, the real axis. The coordinates on the axis are denoted by t for the real one, the real coordinate is t, x for the imaginary one. And then I've also drawn a circle here, right? So the zero is in the middle, the zero real value, zero imaginary value, and then there's 1, 0 for the simply the real value, then 0i for the imaginary point here, and then similarly minus for a different direction. And the red line here, this is basically the way between zero and the imaginary unit, right? The imaginary unit is this value. As coordinates, it has the value 0 and I, so to speak, right? And here you have any real number multiplied by the imaginary unit is the imaginary axis. For reasons that are important for legal theory and so on, I've also drawn a copy of the imaginary axis here. So this copy here, this line here, this is just the same as here. I just drew it on a different point, not just going to for the zero, but going to the number one, which is important in legal theory, because an important theme is that we have, if you have a space, then we have a second important space coming with it if you do anything to do with analysis, namely the tangent space at a point. If I have here a point and I look at any direction to move from there, then you know, if I look at any curves going through the point, then I also have like the velocity at the tangent at that point. And so the one space comes with another space. This, the normal manifold comes with the tangent manifold. And in legal theory, that is to be thought of for reasons relating to the exponential map as the tangent space at one. That's particularly important tangent space, and that's why I have this imaginary axis redrawn also going through one, but never mind for the moment. Then here, for reasons that's also important later, I've written down the imaginary unit here, and I stated, oh, that's the member of a particular set, and this is like a tautology here. I is the member of a set that contains plus I and minus I. It's going to be of relevant only later. And again, basically this point here is the value I. This point would be 1 plus I, and I just emphasized that the I is also here, right? Okay, and so then the distance from 0 to this value here, a little bit more than 2, that might be, let's say this is the distance here, this brown line is 2.3, the distance. As a real value, the coordinate, that's 2.3. And then we might denote distance or the vector there. You know, there are not two things. Either I speak of just the coordinate, or I speak about the complex number, which also always has the I attached. In this image, as a switch around between them, but if you know complex numbers, then it should be clear. So this point is at point 2.3i at a distance of 2.3 from the center. And also here I written down U1, the one-dimensional unitary group. This is the set of elements of the form e to the I, and then some angle, some real number angle theta. This is the theta value would be the angle as this exponential function goes along this circle. You know, the absolute value of the number e to the I times some real number is always 1. So this is why this is the unit circle. This U1 is the set of these numbers together with complex multiplication, which, you know, moves around the circle. And then I've denoted here e to the power of iv, when I interpret v as this value 2.3, this real number. We might leave out the I here if we interpret v as 2.3 times I, right? So I hope this is not too confusing. This is basically if v is 2.3 times I, then this point is, you know, this is the angle 2.3 going from the start here. So this would be e to the power of v if v has the I already in it. Okay. And so this is also why I start here, right? So if you plug in zero as a tangent vector, then e to the power of zero is one. So that's why you start here. And then as you exponentiate, if you go in a direction, if you go in this, like this value here, this 2.3 in any direction in the complex number, there's only one direction, like or you know, in the positive direction in this case, then you move along this set, and that's why it's convenient to write this down here. This is basically the tangent space that leads you then on a way along this circle. This is S1 as a circle, as a topological space. This is S1 as a group. This is U1. It's just names. And so for the quaternion case, especially for the Hamiltonian quaternion, what will happen is that the picture will de facto stay the same. The only thing that will change is that this I becomes not just one value or two values. There will not just be back and forth. This will not be a one-dimensional thing, but this I itself will become any point on a two-dimensional sphere, so S2. This will be like some point that you might think of as in three-dimensional space. So IR, the imaginary axis, will cease to exist one-dimensional. It will become three-dimensional for the particular quaternion algebra with A equals B equals minus one. So this will become basically R3, and the set plus minus one, or this I, will actually become a continuous set, like a continuous manifold of I's, different imaginary units. And they will become a sphere. And so since even if in this case of the Hamiltonian quaternion algebra, even if this I becomes a bunch of different I's, this is a two-dimensional, and the imaginary axis is therefore three-dimensional. You know, you gave from this ball and go radial out, this is three-dimensional. You still have the real space, right? This is going to be the direction of the unit, of the unit matrix. And so, therefore, the whole space is this three-dimensional space plus another dimension that is just a real space. This will stay as it is, right? So again, complex numbers, one real dimension, one imaginary dimension, quaternion, Hamiltonians, the Hamiltonian quaternions are also one real dimension, but three-dimensional imaginary unit, so to speak, three-dimensional imaginary axis. And you will still be able, however, to go along a tangent vector, let's say V, capital V, and move here. And what you get into is not U1, but because the tangent vector is three-dimensional, you will go into a three-dimensional group, right? Spoiler. And the thing that is here, just a circle, will then be a sphere in four-dimensional space, right? This is just fixing in the same way that the complex numbers, which in terms of real dimensions are two-dimensional, are, by going into the group, restricted to one-dimensional, which is compact. The same thing will happen if this is going to be generalized to three dimensions. The group will still be a nice compact group, but it will be three-dimensional. Has the dimension of the tangent space here, which will be three-dimensional. Okay, And also, like, this is not as important, but I have also denoted here a general element in the complex numbers in this case. So this is, in this case, it has the same distance on the imaginary axis as capital V, but then it has also a real component of, let's say, 1.1. And, you know, if this is a complex number, 1.1 plus 2.3 times I, then e to the power of v will go the same angle as this. So this will go over there. But since it has a positive real component, it will also be at a distance of a little bit more than e to the power of 1. So it will end up here, right? This, as a generator of the exponentiation will move there, but that's just as an aside. And all this notation, I hope this is not too confusing. It will help too, because I will use the same notation now in the text. Okay, but always look at the text more than on the picture, right? I draw your own picture. And also, I'm only talking about this particular Hamiltonian quaternions now. We are going to talk more generally for general AB. This will be different quaternions. But nonetheless, the important case is the one with the Hamiltonian. And also, A and B will not be visible too much in the equations nicely enough anyway. Okay, so let's just... Even if you forget everything I said about the picture, let's just make some definitions, right? So given some values x, y, and z in our field, then we might consider this particular 2x2 matrix, right? This is a matrix because I, j, and k are matrices. They are just multiplied by some value. You can view them as a vector in this three-dimensional space where I, j, and k are basis vectors, but it's also just a 2x2 matrix. And this I will denote by v. And a general element, a small v, also has a real component in reference to the picture. You don't have to think about the picture, but this is just now a general element because I also add the last matrix that was not used to define v. This is T times E plus V, right? So referring to the picture, this is basically this point. It has a real component where the one here, is the unit matrix, and it has an imaginary direction as well, right? In the complex numbers, this is just I. Now for the quaternion case, this is higher dimensional, it's three dimensional basically. Okay, so if we just take the definitions of the matrices that we had them before, like if you just, you know, take these two matrices and these two matrices and multiply them with T, X, Y, and Z, then we get this general element. The A is in the field, square root of A might not be. So this is, sadly, I think I should have written... It works out okay. So if you now consider a general field and you don't know whether or not square root of A is in the field. For example, if you think of F as the real numbers and A being... -7, right? You choose a representation with A equals -7, then the square root of -7 is not in the real numbers. So this is a bigger object with some field extension. And this matrix has this square root of -7 in there. So this is not going to be, you know, if F is real, this is not going to be a real matrix. It's being an element in a bigger space of 2x2 matrices with some other base field. but it is therefore a subset. But in the case that the square root of A is already in there, like if, for example, if f is real and A is 3, then the square root of 3 is already a real number, it's already there, then this matrix is actually a general matrix of the 2x2 real matrices, right? You can think about that, like for whatever real matrix or whatever matrix in the field you want to choose, if square root of A is already in the field, then you can tune these four parameters, T, X, Y, and Z, in a way that this fits your parameters. It is basically the case, because when we compute this element, then this negative signs pop up here, and so I describe it here. You can play this. If you don't believe it, then you just choose the real numbers, choose four numbers, and try to fit T, X, Y, and Z so that your matrix is obtained. Okay, so this is just this aside. If this square root of A is already in F, then this is particularly similar. Then your algebra is actually the same algebra as this 2x2 matrix algebra over the field, and you have just chosen a particular basis that you call E, I, and J, and K. Okay, so far so good. You can also if you take this thing here with V, capital V defined like that, I might also write it down like that. This is also clear because there's TE, then XI, and then J is J here is also the unit matrix times J, and K is just I times J, right? So I might also write it down like this. And here you see how this suddenly becomes actually a two-dimensional space over the algebraic structure defined for objects that look like that, right? So in I might not, is a 2x2 matrix that has components that might not be in the field. But if you look at this, the algebraic structure defined by this, this kind of, the span of this thing, right? That where you have one element that commutes with X, and X squared, that commutes with I, and I squared is actually E. So then you have here a two-dimensional thing. This is like for the real numbers and A chosen as minus one, this is literally just the complex numbers here, right? If A is minus one, then this behaves literally like the complex numbers. And here you see that suddenly you have two instances of this structure that behaves like that, right? This structure, E plus I, and then the span of that behaves like exactly like this here. This is the same thing. And this is just as parameters T and X. This is parameters Y and Z, but they are just parameters from the field. So there are two copies now of this structure, and then viewed as dimension of a two-dimensional space spanned by E and J, which itself behaves also like E and I, right? So one way of interpreting it that is like, if you think of two dimensions, like, An analogy to complex numbers, then this would be T, or let me make this smaller. This would be this T. This would be the normal I, you know, whether or not A is minus one or not for this example, like just for this analogy is not important here. But it might be literally the complex numbers if you choose the right field in the right A. And then you have suddenly this extra dimension spanned by J, which is itself two-dimensional. So there's actually two dimensions, and this is the thing that becomes an extra. You might think of it as attached to the imaginary axis. Basically, you have a four. Overall, it's a four-dimensional space, and the the most direct split of it, you think about it, is the real axis, or the you know, the normal axis, the central axis, the axis which commutes with everything that was there and is still there. Structures like the complex numbers have an imaginary one, but now this imaginary space gets two extra dimensions, and these extra dimensions, they don't like each other in the sense that nothing there commutes. This the real one stays the center, is stays the thing that commutes with everything. Previously there was only the thing that commutes with everything, and then I, which commutes with itself and commutes with the other thing. But now, like, I has to make some room and make space for two other dimensions, which are spanned by generator, which don't commute with it. So that's one way of thinking about it. So now that we have the general vision. I still want you to think of A and B completely general, but the picture of how the complex numbers embed into this four-dimensional space is nevertheless still good. Okay, we're going to look at now at functions of it. We're going to we might start about looking at the analysis of things. We have these generators which are non-commutative. This is different, the complex numbers, where complex numbers always commute, but nevertheless, because we are somewhere in between, it's not a super arbitrary non-commuting algebraic structure. There are still so many rules. There are these three axioms, so to speak. They still break down to this algebra not being free in the technical sense, but actually like collapsing to this four-dimensional structure. It turns out that the functions, computing function, is still pretty easy on the quaternions. The most important thing will be computing the determinant, and because the structure is so simple, the determinant will pop up everywhere. So if I scroll up again, you can actually, since our representation of it is a 2x2 matrix, you can compute the determinant by hand. Basically, you know, the determinant is this times this minus this times this. Well, you will see there's a t squared, then, as it had turned out, there's this minus sign, so a lot of things cancel. You're left with t squared minus a times x squared minus b times y squared over c cancels, and then minus a times b z squared, right? I just did it in my head. The determinant is actually something super simple. The determinant is this of a general object, right? V is a general point in this four-dimensional space. The determinant is some characteristic number. It's a number that is in the field, as you can see, right? T, X, Y, and Z, as well as A and B, are in the field. C cancelled out. C is just giving different representations. And this now looks like it is a quadratic form, right? It is actually, if you take the components here, T, X, Y, Z, then this is just an inner product, if you will, with a diagonal matrix with 1 minus A minus B and then A times B. Right, and this is now, like, I argued for the case of previously I argued for the case of A equals B equals minus 1 on the grounds that then I, J, and K behave the same. This is the case where you can actually think of them as this three-dimensional imaginary space. But now what you see here is even more important. The point is this, that if you choose negative numbers for A and B, and then you can rescale them both to minus 1. If you choose negative numbers for A and B, then this is actually just positive numbers, right? And it says, like, if you choose minus 1 for both, then it says 1, 1, 1, and then also 1. And so suddenly you have this quadratic form, which is positive. And then you have something with where the determinant just becomes essentially the distance, right? The determinant, which naturally pops up whenever you do anything with the representation. If you invert it, the determinant will show up. You see now this in that case, the distance. And I mean, it's not too bad if it's not positive. Then you still have this kind of nice object, and you can still look at the groups which leave it invariant. And we'll touch on that later. But this is kind of why the Hamiltonian quaternion case is particularly important, because then you actually can represent you know, real life normal objects like distances in physical space, which is nicely modeled by R3, actually as this imaginary space in on the quaternion Hamiltonian algebra. That's why you can then start to take the quaternions and say, okay, if you have a point in three-dimensional space next to me, then let's think of it as a point in this this imaginary quaternion space where all the basis vectors behave similarly, and so there's no preferred angle. Right? If you choose A positive and B negative, then the dimensions are different to each other, right? Then if A is positive and B negative, then you have positive, 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 negative, negative. What did I say? If you choose A positive and B negative, then you have positive, negative, positive, and the negative, and then you have this kind of 2x2 split and not 1x3 split. Then you also you still have a nice space, but it's different than three-dimensional space here, and then you're dealing with another induced group structure that leaves this quadratic form invariant. Okay, but again, let's leave it general here. So, in the case where this is all positive, then the determinant is also only zero when the point is the zero point. You know, this is, if this is not all positive, then you have a bunch of points where this becomes zero. So in the case where this quadratic form has this positive coefficients, then the quaternion algebra as such is also particularly invertible, right? If the signs are flipped here, then you can find objects from algebraic geometry, some curves in this four-dimensional space along which the determinant is zero, and that means the 2x2 matrices are not invertible along all of these nice surfaces, and you might not want that. Okay, going on. If you have the split between real and imaginary, and if I say real and imaginary in the quaternion case, I really just mean the center, like the real thing is that which commutes with everything, aka the center. And that which is not the center, right? This is the real imaginary. You might also say the center and the poor quaternions, like the poor are the imaginary ones. You know, you might, these are just words. I will say the real and imaginary, you know what I mean. The real is always the center. Then we can define this involution operation. So this flips the sign of the pure part, of the imaginary part. And there is like an super important connection between quadratic forms and involutions. This is what this fig book is about, that is referenced in the Quaternion algebra book. And this conjugated V, this conjugated quaternion element, has then the property that we can define the determinant in terms of an inner product, and suddenly we're really just into, you know, linear algebra domain. Yeah, you can compute that yourself. I mean, it's not surprising that the inverse has something to do with the determinant, right? How to invert a 2x2 matrix, you divide by the determinant, and you flip along the diagonal, and then you get this thing. So you see that this involution is actually given by just inversion times the determinant, and then you can use this these properties to find various relations. For example, this this product, like the conjugated with the V, so you know, remember this, a 2x2 matrices, this is just the conjugated matrix, like conjugated in that sense, and then you have all these relations and you can compute stuff. Since the conjugate is related to the inverse, you find that this is actually that. So this inner product of V and the conjugated V, like is like a quantum, like a, it's just like in a Hilbert space, like a inner product that leads into the center. You know, the result of the matrix multiplication of these matrices is like also like all the basis vectors squared, proportional to E. Maps to the determinant, and the determinant I will also refer to it as norm, or you know, or then there's lots of ways, like this quantitative form, reduced norm, whatever. So suddenly we have here in a product, it behaves like a Hilbert space, similar to a Hilbert space. It's, you know, we're not dealing with complex numbers. In general, we're dealing with a generalized, like general field, but we have all these algebraic properties. And for a general element, not just the basis vectors, but since the basis vectors, the most of them don't compute with each other, if you just multiply V by V, then you get some mixing terms, by which I mean that the nice thing is that you have, on the one hand, something that is proportional to the center, and then the determinant of the capital V, so this is not dependent of T. But then you also have this this stuff which goes in the direction of the imaginary direction, and this is proportional to V. However, the nice thing is that if we just look at elements which have no component in T, where T is zero, right? If you look at pure elements of the quaternion space, if you look at pure or imaginary elements, then the result is that the square of them is always proportional to the unit. So in that sense, they all behave like imaginary units. So what you want to do is actually you say, oh, let's actually take a V, like element that is just in this three dimensions, in the three non-commutative dimensions. And if you then say you choose x, y, and c, right, this is the components of this is the v direction, which is three dimensional in the general case. Now if x, y, and c, x squared plus c squared plus z squared are unit, if this has basically with respect, okay, let's talk about the Hamiltonians first. If with respect to the Hamiltonians, these are norm to one, then you see suddenly that all points on a two-dimensional sphere, all points with x squared plus c squared plus z squared, these behave all like the imaginary unit, because wherever they are, even if they are not I, j, and k, whatever they are, they will just square to minus one, basically minus an element in the center, right? So in that sense, in the case of the Hamiltonians, you have a whole like sphere of imaginary units, and yeah, that's that. Basically the generalization that you think of is that just that the imaginary axis becomes three-dimensional. And in that sense, you know, take this three-dimensional space, pick any element on the sphere in this three-dimensional space, then and look at the axis at the ray going from zero, right? Then here, for the Hamiltonians, you have an embedding of your complex numbers, right? The complex numbers like for every point on this two sphere, there is one version of the complex numbers because they all behave like the complex numbers. But on this page, everything you see here is actually like coming back now. Everything on this page here is not assuming a equals minus one or b equals minus one or whatnot. This is all just general. The funny thing is all these calculations that you see here, they are basically like theory of quadratic forms and so on. So there's, I left it on this page here, general. All these calculations here turn out like that, no matter what the quaternion algebra is. No matter what the representation is, really. Okay, yeah, so since even the square is relatively simple, right? The A and B don't pop up, just the coordinates and the space you started with, you can compute it like that. Then it turns out that the power series are also simple, right? So you know what V square it is. Now you can do a little bit algebra and compute V to the power of 2n, right? Now here is an brought the some function of x. X is some abstract slot, let's say, some power series. You know how to compute that after some thinking, like what you know, you just must use some commutation relations. Okay, here I just recall the basic definitions of how the exponential function can be defined in terms of the cosine hyperbolicos. I don't know how to pronounce it in English. Okay, then I make some definition. I call this R, and that I call this n. The R is basically the norm. This is the normalized, in a sense, element of this sphere. In the imaginary three-dimensional space. And then turns out that e to v, e to the exponential series of some completely general quaternion algebra element, it factors. So e to the power of small v is e to the power of t times e to the power of v. So you have the split, like with the complex numbers, right? So you know, if you have any complex number, then this you can write it as some distance from zero, some real number times e to the power of I, the angle. And the same thing happens here, basically. V is like, in the analogy, is I times some angle. And still, this is not assuming anything about A or B. This is completely general. And then you can you find, if you compute that, you know, you can type it into Mathematica. You find out that e to the power of capital V is just this nice thing. And it completely reduces. And this thing, you know, if you use the relation of cosine hyperbole for matrices as well, then you find that, plug it in and... the determinant of this is one. So this is actually this e to the power of v. V is a 2x2 matrix. E to the power of a matrix is also a matrix, some matrix, and this is actually a special matrix. The determinant of that is actually one. And suddenly, you're in group theory. You discover that the exponential takes you from the imaginary space interpreted as a tangent space into some group element. And I will not dwell on that too much. But turns out that in the theory of quadratic forms, and then the SOQ here by the denote isometries that leave the quadratic form invariant, then you actually embed into this space of form invariant, like of group elements that leave the quadratic form invariant with the exponential function. Okay. how many minutes am I speaking already? Oh yeah. so going on, just some simple observations, right? This is a general algebra observation. If you have any GH, some two matrices, it's more general actually, but if you want to talk about the determinant, in that case, we want to talk about matrices. And we map V to G times V times H to the minus one. then we might look at the determinant of that, right? This is a relevant object for us. And we see the determinant of the transformed V turns out like that, right? Simple rules of the determinants. And so that means that whenever G and H have the same determinant, then this actually leaves V invariant. And for us, V, as we have seen, is actually a quadratic form, or in the case of the Hamiltonians, is actually a norm. And so we see we can very simply find a bunch of transformations which leaves a norm invariant. Right? We just have to do the multiplication by left and right by some matrices that have this property that this is one, that this is nothing. And so suddenly we know how to represent norm, like isometries, really. Okay. And also this is not unique. Like if you, for example, these are matrices. So if we flip the sign of the whole matrix, then if you want to pull it out of the determinant, then it will be just vanished. So we see that this is not actually a surjection of matrices and transformations of V. Of course, I talked about it more than enough already. If you have the special case A equals B equals minus 1, then suddenly the determinant or this inner product or this norm becomes particularly simple. And so we're at the quaternions. I already explained this really going on in the video. I already talked about the interpretation of the non-commuting dimensions as this three-dimensional imaginary axis. And what's more, if you do a matrix multiplication, you actually find out that suddenly this multiplication, so if we looked at the general element, the general squared v times v, then it was this kind of thing, right? We had one part which is proportional to one, and one part in that relates to t, but still we had v times v, a matrix with itself. If we now look at some element from the, especially the imaginary quaternions, so the pure quaternions, and multiply two different elements together, then we find out actually that this is also easy to compute. On the one hand, the inner product, which is given by the components and the form, whatever you have here, and the non-commutative part is actually given by taking the coordinates, the components, and doing the three-dimensional cross product. So this is a way of actually, in a way, introducing the cross product as well. So you compute the new components. You take this three dimensions. You take the components. You compute the cross product, you know, of three dimensional elements, and then you take the result as the components for this ij and k again, and then you get some matrix here. So this represents this matrix where the components are computed by the cross product. And this is actually not too surprising, because if you multiply 2x2 matrices together, then you have, you know, two elements here multiplied plus two elements there multiplied, and that's exactly how the cross product looks. You multiply two things minus two other things, or turn around things, right? So this is not too surprising, but it's a way of introducing the cross product as well. So this is the rule. And finally, I talked about how there's this obvious, you know, adjoined way of introducing transformations by left and right multiplication by G and H. So let me scroll up for a quick moment again. When are the determinants of G and H the same? Well, especially if G and H are the same thing, right? So either if you just look at that as a function of just G, you know, you plug in G times V times G to the power of minus one, then this is trivially one, and you have suddenly a map of like 2x2 matrices to a transformation that leave V invariant. And similarly, you might also just take two. You might restrict yourself to taking G and H to matrices which already have a fixed determinant. You know, without restriction of generality, take G and H as special matrices. Then suddenly you have a map from two matrices from some special group that leave this invariant. So you have, just by this formula and just by taking the right G and H, you have various ways of introducing isometries of this of the quaternions, and that's the origin of how the SU2, this is the you know the group that you get by exponentiating this three-dimensional imaginary axis, then you get to the SU2. This is the analogy to U1. Then you get in this way one transformation which leaves the V invariant, and this is the just a rotation of three-dimensional V's V taken from three dimension. And similarly, you can take two different matrices from SU2. This is the case where you see, oh, this is my G, this is my H. And because they already have a unit determinant themselves, the transformation also doesn't introduce any breaking of the determinant of V. And in this way, you also introduce this, and you can use this to transform actually four-dimensional ones. Well, you know, the quaternions are four-dimensional, so that's the most you can get. And turns out, and as I said, this is not a rejection of matrices into these transformations. So you have this covering, SU2 covers SO3 doubly, and similarly you have a cover of these six dimensions. You have three dimensions here, and suddenly you have this this bigger group, and this is covers then the SO4. Okay, and with that I'm at the end of this. I hope it was not too quick or too boring. Either way, I will continue going more into the Lie group direction and Lie algebra direction, and these quaternions will also come back as examples when I look at, let's say, category of groups. Maybe I take more from the book, even though, like I'm, as you have seen in a few previous videos, I'm interested in also more the analytic kind of things. And this nice book by Voigt on quaternion algebras talks about all the nice set of functions. I might cover more of that or go back to the small book on Lie algebras. In any case, subscribe to the channel, and thanks for watching.